Okay, so first, our first segment here is on Adam and Eve. And so basically, this is just meant to be a dialogue. We can talk back and forth. Now, as I understand it, you believe that... why don't you give me a quick overview of how you believe that Adam and Eve were created?
Yes, well, you know, when it comes to the creation account regarding human origins, there's two prominent views among evangelicals. One would say that the account of human origins is theologically true, but it's not historically and scientifically true necessarily. And then another group of evangelicals, which I would be part of, would argue that it is actually a historical account. And if that's the case, then we would expect that there should be scientific evidence that lines up with the biblical account of human origins. And so I would look at the biblical account at face value, that there was literally an Adam and an Eve that were created through God's direct intervention, made in his image.
Okay, so to summarize, tell me if you think this is fair or not. I think you might be what they call a progressive creationist, where God, through the eons, you know, like maybe at 1 million years, he created these creatures. Another 1 million years later, he created another set of creatures. So at some point in time, he created humans where there was no humans at all. And then boom, the next day there's Adam and Eve. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah, I would be called a progressive creationist. And you did, I think, a really good job of describing that position.
Okay, so in your worldview, in your theology, in your scientific understanding, there was a point in history where one day there was no humans at all, and the next day, what, there's two humans, just Adam and Eve, and then all humans descended from those two?
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah, I would take the view that they were the first human beings, again, created, as you mentioned, through God's direct and personal intervention, mm-hmm. that they have no connection historically to creatures like Neanderthals or Homo erectus that preceded modern humans in the fossil record, and that all humanity ultimately descends from an Adam and an Eve.
So like a Neanderthal then is also a separate creature, a separate creation, just kind of boom, there's a Neanderthal where there was nothing before that.
Yes, exactly. That's right.
Okay, now would you, and you would also say that for all the other major animals, like for example, hippos, elephants, lions, and tigers, there's a point in time where there is none, and then there's a certain point where boom, all of a sudden there's a bunch of tigers?
Yeah, that's in a sense that would be the position. Although from my perspective, while I'm a skeptic of aspects of the evolutionary paradigm, I would allow for some evolution happening at in a limited extent. So I have no problem with the idea of microevolution or speciation, where you would have God creating a design, and then that design is capable of varying, again, through natural process mechanisms. So, you know, but yes, in a sense, we would argue that with each of the creatures that we see, the basic design that is represented by that creature, the archetype, is essentially the product of a creator's activity.
Mm-hmm. And like evolutionists, for example, will say that there were mammals on land and they went back into sea, and that's how we have whales, for example. So you would say, no, that never happened, that there was just a point in time when, boom, there were some kind of whale creature.
Yeah, that there was a creation event, exactly.
Okay. Let me throw this out there and see what you think about this. I believe that... You know, sometimes people say there's science versus religion, and I would argue that, and I know you would argue against that. And I'd like to say that basically the argument really is magical thinking versus scientific thinking. And the scientific thinking would be, for example, evolution, which explains how things emerge, whereas magical thinking is, you know, like boom, things pop into existence. You know, you could say creation by poof, you know, there it is, poof. And that's it. What would you have to say about that?
Well, you know, let's put it this way. I wouldn't frame it as, again, magical thinking versus scientific thinking, because, for example, I think science has the capacity to detect whether or not intelligent agency is involved in a causative event. So, for example, if you look at the archaeological record, we have stone tools that creatures like, let's say, Homo habilis produced. Anthropologists and archaeologists are capable of examining a rock and determining that that rock was the product of intelligent agency versus that the rock was shaped through natural processes. And so my view would be not, again, magical thinking versus scientific thinking, but rather that science has the capacity to detect the work of an intelligent agent. And so we would argue that when we look at the history of life on Earth, we see places where it does look like intelligent agency was involved in bringing about, again, the origin or the existence of particular life forms.
So, but and, you brought up Homo habilis. So you're saying that's not a human, though, right?
No. Well, I mean, I would argue it's not a modern human or Homo sapiens sapiens, and that it would that creature would have lacked what I would understand to be the image of God.
Okay.
But it would be a human in the sense that it belongs to the genus Homo.
So that's a different species than, like, Adam and Eve, for example. I mean, Adam and Eve are one kind of species, and that's a different species. They shouldn't be, they wouldn't mate, or maybe they did because of sin, or what?
Oh, no, I mean Homo habilis was cognitively different than modern humans. It was, the creature was clearly biologically distinct from modern humans.
Okay.
And so, the way I would think of that creature would be in the same vein that I would think of chimpanzees, orangutans, and gorillas, creatures that had intelligence, had emotional capability, creatures that were, fascinating creatures in their own right, but yet distinct species from modern humans.
Would you say they had a soul? Because some people say only humans have souls, and some people say all the animals have souls.
I would say that they had again intelligence and emotional capability, but I would not say that they bore the image of God. That would be the terminology that I would use.
And what is the image of God exactly? Because as far as I can tell, it's never defined. So what would you say is the image of God?
Yeah, well, that's a fair question or a fair point, because Scripture makes the assertion that human beings are made in God's image, but it doesn't define what that means precisely. And so, theologians have debated that over the centuries. And the particular view that I embrace would be something called a resemblance view, where human beings have certain capabilities, advanced cognitive capabilities that would resemble, though imperfectly, but resemble that of the Creator. So we would have the capacity for abstract thought, for language and artistic and musical expression, and things like that. And so that capability would be something that an anthropologist would label as symbolism. So the closest scientific analog to the image of God, I would argue, is symbolism.
But it seems like we see that in the lower life forms, too. I mean, there's a lot of, they display some communication abilities. I mean, even, Franz de Waal wrote that book of Primates and Philosophers, and he talked about emergent signs of morality with chimps and... okay, well, we're almost out of time on this topic. One thing I really wanted to bring up, is there anything you wanted to say? I mean, I want to cut you off. Is there anything you want to say before I ask another subtopic here?
No, that's fine. We can move on.
Okay, one thing I'm really chomping at the bit to know about is, I know you talked to Dennis Vina before. You've had debates with him. He's a Christian practicing scientist who fully accepts evolution. And in his video, he talks about how pseudogenes are, evidence of evolution. Just the fact that, and he cites this paper about the olfactory sense alone, where there is a study of like 50 of these pseudogenes for the olfactory sense. This is our sense of smelling. And for example, there's one gene that everything in the line of descent inherits. And then if you look at where the orangutans branch off, there's three more pseudogenes that the gorillas and the chimps and the humans inherit or seem to have. Then if you break off the gorilla branch, there's three that the chimp and the human share, and then when you go off that branch, the chimps have 4 and the humans have 15. So it seems like there's an obvious descent here. So why, I don't understand, why is this not obvious slam dunk evidence that humans evolved from other animals?
Well, you know, we actually addressed that question pretty significantly in the update to Who Was Adam that we just published. And basically what we point out is that this idea that pseudogenes are non-functional doesn't have, I think, any kind of genuine scientific support.
Let me interrupt. The argument is not that they're non-functional. It's just that, I mean, you can actually see the gene, how it's expressed, and this is the olfactory sense. They have the ability to sense smells, and we don't because we have genes that are hacked up. And so we no longer have that sense, but we have the gene. So it's not a matter of non-functional genes. It's a matter of seeing how these genes are chopped up through descent according to evolutionary trees.
Yeah, well, and I talk about this also in the update to Who Is Adam, is that when you actually are building evolutionary trees with humans, chimps, bonobos, and gorillas, and orangutans, is that depending on the particular section of the genome that you look at, you actually get different trees. So, for example, certain regions of the human genome are much more closely aligned with the gorilla genome than with the chimpanzee genome. And that's about 30%, if I'm not mistaken, I'm going off the top of my head at the moment, I think it's about 30% of the gorilla genome more closely aligns with the human genome than the chimp genome. So the idea that you see that particular relationship with those sets of genes is actually, again, looking at a particular set of genes in particular regions of the genome. If you went to other regions, you get a very different story. And so, to me, that incoherence is raising certain questions. And I think, you know, again, I think you can't explain those patterns that you see in the context that there is a functional reason why those patterns exist. And by the way, when you actually examine some of the pseudogenes, you don't get that relationship. Some of the olfactory pseudogenes, you actually get a different relationship.
Okay, so what I hear you saying is, okay, so are you denying then, you know the paper he's referring to, right? That it was
Yes.
It's called Human Specific Loss of Olfactory Receptor Genes. Are you saying that this paper is flawed?
No, I wouldn't say that. What I would say is that the way in which the data is interpreted is from within the context of an evolutionary framework.
Okay, so I think what you're saying is they're cherry picking that there is, it looks like there is a sequence that shows evolution, but there's other sequences that do not line up this way, and they are not mentioning that. So are you basically saying they're cherry picking here?
No, I wouldn't use that term at all. I think how I would describe it is that they're interpreting the data within a particular context, within a particular framework, that you could actually adopt an alternate framework, one that would employ design as an organizing principle, and equally interpret the data in a design context where you're seeing functionality.
So here's a specific question. So it says, there's this mammalian gene sequence, they're saying, and then they're saying that the humans have 15 corrupted versions, so no longer have those sense of smells for those certain things. And then if you go up a level between the human and chimp, there's 3 more. And if you go up a level between the gorilla one, a branch, there's 3 more. And if you go up before the orangutan branch, there's 1 more. So we have these genes that no longer sense these smells, but as you go, I'm trying to understand, if God made humans uniquely from scratch, why would we have these genes that, you know, you could say maybe they found a function for it, the body uses a function for some of these, but it's obviously these are made for the olfactory sense because that's how they actually work in other ancestral streams.
Well, but a couple of things that are in play here is, number one, there's been some recent work, again, in understanding pseudogene function, and there's an idea emerging called the competitive endogenous RNA hypothesis, where the argument is that messenger RNA molecules are not only harboring information that would be used to translate proteins during the process of gene expression, but that the information in messenger RNA is also playing a regulatory role, regulating the gene expression patterns of other RNA molecules, that you have RNAs that are part of this integrated network of RNA molecules where the expression of one RNA is regulating or controlling the expression of other RNAs and the process of approaching of translation at ribosomes as well. And so even though those pseudogenes may not be coding functional receptor proteins, they still are actually taking an active role in that regulatory network.
You know, but, so, yeah, but what seems so strange about that is that you're saying here God made humans from scratch, and let's say he needs some kind of regulatory action, and so he designs that with the code that happens to be a chopped up version that is the same of olfactory sense in a different creature that works in the olfactory sense. Doesn't that seem strange?
You're looking at it from an evolutionary framework. Prior to Darwin, the theoretical construct in biology was largely developed by Sir Richard Owen, who developed this concept of an archetype, who argued that shared features that you see in organisms, at this time he's dealing at an anatomical level, but shared features reflected the work of a creator that employed a common archetype. And that archetype then is manifested in different ways within the created order. And he saw that as being, again, reflecting the work of a creator, or the ideas or concepts that existed in the mind of a creator. So the concept here is that shared features reflect common design, not common descent, where even though human beings would be uniquely made in God's image, it doesn't mean that we wouldn't necessarily share biological features with other creatures, but you could see those shared features as reflecting a common design, not common descent. And in that framework, then you would expect to see a function as opposed to a non-function for features like pseudogenes. And what I point out in the update to Who Was Adam is that are discovering almost universal function for pseudogenes. And this includes duplicated and unitary pseudogenes, and that function relates not to the production of proteins in terms of the pseudogenes encoding information that translates into protein products, but they play a role in terms of gene regulation through this organizing concept that's being built, the competitive endogenous RNA hypothesis.
It doesn't make sense to me, because it sounds like what you're saying to me is that, let's say, example, God created some kind of a mammal with genes for the olfactory sense. And then what happens is, when he made humans, we don't have that olfactory sense anymore. But he says, oh, I'm going to use that same code and hack it up and use it for some other process, when he could have made something from scratch, I guess. But it's like, why would you? It's like this block of code is copied and modified, but it just doesn't seem to make sense if he was making things from scratch. But yeah, I think we have to leave it there to move on.
Sure.
I'll give you just 20 seconds if you just want to just quickly end this section on this.
Yeah, and I would basically make the point that what people oftentimes are pointing to as overwhelming evidence for common descent and human evolution are features in nature that could be interpreted from a design framework or a creation framework, and have ready explanation within that framework.
Okay, well, we went twice as long on this one, so we're gonna have to take out some time on the other ones. So the other one.